video going?
Original intent, understanding the meaning and essence of the Constitution. This marvelous creation, which I find kind of boring to read, actually. I think I've read it several times and listened to it on tape 3 times. It isn't really boring. It's just that, you know, I think, boy, we've got to get beyond that level. This is the beginner's level. This is Constitution 101. Maybe that's why it's exciting to the American people right now. It's the beginning level, written on a level that the average American can read and understand. The 28 great principles that our founding fathers implemented to make America a wonderful country. And they've all been shattered. This is the principle we're going to deal with right now in the next hour. Only limited and carefully defined powers should be delegated to government, all others being retained in the people. And if we follow that power or that principle, the sun would rise on America once again. The Liberty Bell. We're going to do it. Everyone please stand. We're going to stand for the ringing of the Liberty Bell. I was in Philadelphia in 2007, and I went and took this picture myself. Most of the pictures that you see on my display are out of magazines and books. I photographed that one myself through a glass window. They wouldn't let me into the room. It was after hours. And we're going to have the ringing of the Liberty Bell. Get ready. Thank you. Thank you. That's very good. Thank you. Thank you. I don't have any sound effects on the computer. Okay, we get past that. The Liberty Bell. Okay. 3 words. This lesson is going to be focusing on 3 words. And these 3 words are critical to understanding. You heard in the last lesson. Did we federalize or did we nationalize? We federalized. Had we nationalized, we would have been the same as provinces under the supervision and leadership of a powerful central government. We didn't nationalize, we federalized. So first we're going to talk about federalism, and then we're going to talk about enumeration. So if we federalized, that means we had different levels of government. And so we had enumerated powers given to the different levels. And then the third thing we must understand is separation. Separation of powers. Okay, 1 word at a time. Federalism. That's another picture I took. We'll close with that slide tonight. I stood there in front of Independence Hall, and I photographed that picture myself. That was the only time I've ever been there, and I never want to go again. Federalism. 2 levels of government. State and central. In the Federalist Papers, we read, the powers delegated by the proposed Constitution to the federal government are few and defined. Those which are to remain in the state governments are numerous and indefinite. The former will be exercised principally on external objects, as war, peace, negotiation, and foreign commerce, with which last the power of taxation will, for the most part, be connected. The powers reserved to the several states will extend to all the objects which, in the ordinary course of affairs, concern the lives, liberties, and properties of the people, and the internal order, improvement, and prosperity of the state. Now, that's a long statement. Let's kind of pick it apart here. The powers delegated by the proposed Constitution are few and defined. Ah, not numerous and indefinite. Is that what our federal government does today? Do they believe in few and defined powers? No, they believe in numerous and indefinite. Okay, so we're learning something. This is an explanation coming from James Madison of the original Constitution. A little background. The Federalist Papers was written in the state of New York by 3 men, Hamilton, Madison, and Jay, to try and explain the original intent of the Constitution. And like I mentioned about Hamilton, I sometimes question his sincerity because not long after that he changed his tune. Nevertheless, during this presentation of the Federalist Papers, he does a pretty good job of expounding the original intent. But this is James Madison speaking. So the powers delegated are few and defined. Are these ceded? Does it say the powers ceded to the federal government? Does it say the powers granted to the federal government? It says the powers delegated, and we also know that that means what powers? Vested powers. Powers delegated, powers vested, not granted, not ceded. They go on. The federal and state governments are in fact but different agents and trustees of the people, constituted with different powers and designed for different purposes. Now that's I'm going to show you a picture of that here in a moment. The federal and state governments are in fact different agents. Does it say officials? No, agents, hired public servants. They're agents and trustees of the people, constituted with different powers and designed for different purposes. This book is just a great read. I hope it arrives for next week, and some of you will wade through it. I read it this year for the second time. I mean, it's powerfully helpful. It's the best single book I have ever seen to explain the original intent and give you the documentation, so it's just overwhelming. He could have given me 3 examples, but he gives you like 14 to make his points. The Republic of Republics by Bernard Janet Sage. Oh, let's pause for a moment. Bernard Janet Sage, he was a lawyer, a Southern lawyer. He was in charge of, he was invited by Jefferson Davis to prepare Jefferson Davis's court case for the greatest trial of the century that never took place. It never took place because, this is what happened. Who's Jefferson Davis?
President of the Southern States.
The North arrested Jefferson Davis following the Civil War. They threw him in jail. They treated him rudely and crudely and announced boldly they were going to hang him for treason. Okay, but they thought they should have a trial first. You know, they were going to hang him, but they thought it might be a nice thing to, you know, go through the formalities. We know he's guilty of treason. And so Jefferson Davis was put in jail. He was abused, not beaten, but he was abused like they left the lights on all night. I don't know how they kept the kerosene lanterns going that much, but it says they left the lights on all night, and they had guards marching back and forth continuously in front of his jail cell all night, all day, all night, knocking their feet on the floor, back and forth, and they wouldn't speak to him. Okay, this is harassment. Treated unkindly, very unkindly. This went on for months. Meanwhile, the North is preparing their case, and Bernard Janin Sage is preparing his. He's one of the legal counsel for Jefferson Davis for a trial that he dearly wanted to enter. And Jefferson Davis also, he demanded a trial. The North hired the best lawyers money could buy. And it names them in the story that tells, you know, where you read this history. It names which lawyer. And then another lawyer. And the lawyers that they're the highest paid high buck lawyers, they looked at the case and they says, won't touch it. If you go into court with what we've got here, you'll lose. And the North will be proven to be in the wrong. The whole war will have been fought in vain. I'm not going to touch that case. You've never heard this story, have you? Most people haven't. This is the story of the trial that never came to court because the North finally backed out and wouldn't take it to court. After having this experience twice, and Bernard Janet Sage and his attorneys ready to go to court, Jefferson Davis champing at the bit, I want my day in court. And the North finally said, we're going to give you a pardon. I won't accept a pardon. Oh, why not? Because I want to go to court and prove that the South was right and the North was wrong. Oh, we won't have that. Finally, they just opened the door and turned him loose after 2 years of holding him in jail without charges. You're in law enforcement, aren't you?
What?
Yes, 2 years in jail without charges. Is that a nice thing to do today? No, that's not what we do. That's not how we handle law enforcement. Anyway, that's Bernard Janin Sage. He's a colorful character. His pen name was P.C. Sense, spelled C-E-N-T-Z, and it stood for Plain Common Sense. That was his pen name. Great author, great writer. Okay, now I've told you enough about it. I hope I get him here for you. He says on page 322, he says, draw a line from point A to point B. And Tyler labeled this line, domain on which sovereignty is to act. Now, there's a state, with other words, that this line A, B represent a state. And sovereignty is going to act upon this state. Now, let's find out what the sovereign... Where does all power lie in America originally? In the people. Okay, here's Bernard Jannen Sage's diagram. He says, put a point C and let that represent the federal servants, the agents that you have hired and given a few specific delegated powers, and they are going to have a certain responsibility over this domain. They are going to be like servants carrying out their assigned duties, few and defined. He says, put a point D, and then let this represent the state servants, and draw lines down to the domain over which they are responsible. And think of these public servants, the federal and the state, as being servants in a farmer's field. They each have a different assignment. Some take care of the corn patch and others take care of the livestock. Simple enough, we can grasp that, can't we? Ah, he says, but above them, he says, put point E, because the people are responsible to see that these people, their agents, carry out their assigned duties. All power is in the people. Now, this is an 1878 diagram. It would work very well in the schools today if they would just teach it. Here's another diagram from the 1878 book. Note, each Republican citizen has two capacities. We see here that the people govern and the people are governed. Sovereignty in the people. The people then, through their representatives, created a constitution. The constitution created a form of government, and then the people voluntarily submitted to that program which they had established through their representatives. It's a beautiful program. This was how it originally worked. The ultimate authority resides in the people alone. That's from Federalist number 46, and that's James Madison speaking. Note, the federal government was to represent the states and not the people. Now today we have the federal government trying to meddle in everybody's individual life. And we can give numerous examples of that. Did you get your, what was that check they sent out to everybody a few months ago? Your stimulus check? Did you get your? You don't raise your hands, please. You know, did you get your stimulus check? They're gonna meddle in everybody's life. But originally, the federal government was to represent the states, and not the people. Here's how he diagrams it. This is page 319. I just love this diagram. The people as sovereign communities, and then he gives the short version of each one of them up here. I think I got that out of the zip codes. The people as sovereign communities, like Maryland, Rhode Island, Connecticut, New York, New Jersey, Pennsylvania, and so on, they sent delegates to a convention. That convention created the Constitution, which created the government, and then the people voluntarily submitted themselves to the program that they had created. Now, this diagram will show again, twisted around to fit today's system of government. He twisted it then in 1878. He saw what happened, already had happened, and he redrew this diagram. That comes up a little later. Note, social issues belong to the states. Prayer in school, abortion, same-sex marriage, sodomy, these are state issues. So the state of Texas passed a law, and the Supreme Court overturned the state of Texas law in a case called Lawrence versus Texas, and said that Texas cannot pass a law against sodomy. Why, those people need to have their rights too. And the Supreme Court overturned it. With other words, this is not believed anymore either. Article 3, Section 3. Treason against the United States shall consist only in levying war against them or in adhering to their enemies. But who does them refer to? Them and there. Who are they? Who's that? The states. I used to always think it was the people. No. It's or the United States. No, it's the individual states. Treason is levying war against the states or adhering to the state's enemies. That's a very thought-provoking thing. Let's ask a question. What if a gigantic faction decided to wrest control of America and impose their own political agenda upon the whole United States by levying war against them? A political faction levying war against the United States. If that happened, or giving aid and comfort to the enemies of the United States. If that happened, what crime would that faction be committing? Treason. It happened. It's still going on. How do we know which powers belong to which branch of government? Okay, that first word we dealt with was federalism. Separation of powers, federalism, enumeration. How do we know which powers belong to which branch? Enumeration, which means enumeration of powers. This is another diagram, page 335 of Sage's book. This is a cabinet. Now you understand, back in those days, it was the challenge was make a nice picture by carving on the end grain of a block of wood. That's how this picture was made. I do it. I'm a specialist at it. You carve on the end grain of a block of wood to make it print and look like that. It's quite a challenge. A lot of fun. There's an organization. You can join it if you want. One more club to belong to. The Wood Engravers Network. I'm a member. Okay, so using cutting tools, they carve and they make this cabinet and they print it in this book. And then Bernard Jannen Sage says, let this cabinet represent the repository of powers prepared in written form and pigeonholed. Now each of those little boxes there, like mailboxes, is a pigeonhole. And this is the treasury of powers. So all the powers that are held by the people are in these pigeonholes. Then he says, for example, delegate 70 powers to state government. Now that could be a different number. What we delegate, we can take back. Our powers can be delegated or removed. We can delegate more or less. So he says, for example, delegate 70 powers to state government. So you see 70 of the mailboxes here empty, of the pigeonholes, and suggest 20 powers to the federal government. Now by the way, 20 is a good legitimate number. There are 20 specific enumerated powers found in the Constitution. 20. Now, retain the rest, that's 91 to 120. See, the boxes are still full. To make that, you snip a little bit of wood out, and where you snip out the wood, it leaves no ink, and it prints white. And that's how you get these boxes looking like there's little stacks of paper in them. Okay? They're going to have retained powers down here. Massachusetts State Constitution, this is the original back in the old days, it reads, all power residing originally in the people and being derived from them, the several magistrates and officers of government vested with authority, whether legislative, executive, or judicial, are their substitutes and agents and are at all times accountable to them. They are vested with authority, and these public servants are at all times accountable to the people that hired them. Limit the power of the central government. That's what the Constitution's all about. That's why this contract was written, to limit the power of the central government. Article 1, Section 1. All legislative powers. I'd have you turn to it. What page is it? Page 1? Turn, try it. Keep moving around in your Constitution booklet. Get familiar with the little pages there. Article 1, Section 1. Sometimes people say to me, that's just your opinion. Or that's just your interpretation. I'm going to let you interpret the Constitution tonight. We're going to start out with the first sentence of the Constitution. And we're not going to start with the preamble, we're starting with the first sentence. Article 1, Section 1, Clause 1. All legislative powers herein granted shall be vested in a Congress of the United States, which shall consist of a Senate and a House of Representatives. Now, is there any question as to what that means? Take, for example, the first word. What is it?
All.
All. What does all mean? What does no pets mean? Ask a liberal what all means. Ask a conservative what all means. And you get all sorts of different answers. What does all really mean if you ask Thomas Jefferson? 67%. 93? Going? Isn't this ridiculous to even talk about it? And yet most of the legislation that takes place today it's not even seen in Congress. They don't even see what goes into the Federal Register with 70,000 pages a year. Huh? Yeah, most of the laws are made outside the halls of Congress. Wow. How about the president making law? George W. Bush wrote more than 1,000 signing statements denouncing what the Congress had passed, changing what they had passed, and defying them. And the Congress never did a thing. So the Congress would pass a law, the president would look at it and say, well, I disagree with this part and I won't follow it. And he signed what's called a signing statement, making law from the executive department.
Cheney loved it.
The law that governs those who govern. That's what it was meant to be. The law that governs those who govern. The first article, Article 1, says, the Congress shall have power too. And that it enumerates the specific powers of Congress. It's the law that governs those who govern, or it was supposed to be. Article 2, the executive power shall be vested in a president. Does it say ceded to the president, granted to the president? No, it's going to be vested. He's going to get his vest, and it's going to say Home Depot on it, or Smith and Edwards store, or it's going to say the duties of the president are, and it's going to list the specific duties. The president shall. Then it says what he shall and shall not do. He shall be the commander-in-chief of the Army and Navy once they're called into duty, but not before. Is that significant? When's the last time Congress had an official declaration of war? Which year?
41.
Would you believe 43? Oh, I see a skeptical look on his face. We all think the last one was with Japan or Germany or somewhere right in there. Actually, it was with Romania, as I recall. That was about a year later. We had Romania and two or three of those countries right in there. But it was in the Second World War is the last time we declared war. And since then, we have always ignored it and let the president take over the war powers. Huh? Why don't we follow the contract? The law that governs those who govern. Article 3, the judicial power shall be vested in courts with such exceptions and under such regulations as Congress shall make. This is the famous exception clause. I wished it were famous. It's really not. Nobody even knows a thing about it. Except Congressman Ron Paul knows about it. He uses the exceptions clause, but he can't get a wake up among his peers. For example, the Sanctity of Life Act. We could overturn the entire Roe versus Wade blood-whore scenario by Congress passing the Sanctity of Life Act with a simple majority. Yeah, and it comes before Congress every year by Congressman Ron Paul bringing it up, putting it into the hopper. Do you think our congressmen from Utah are rushing out there to try and abolish and do away with this heinous practice? No, they don't pay any attention to it. Maybe the new one will. He was here in Beaver. Bear with it. Maybe he will. Back to the Federalist Papers. In the first place, it is to be remembered that the general government is not to be charged with the whole power of making and administering laws. Its jurisdiction is limited to certain enumerated objects, which concern all the members of the Republic. That's pretty clear, isn't it? The central government does not have unlimited power to create laws about anything they want. Their powers are enumerated and concern all of the members of the Republic. You can't make a law in Washington, D.C. to bail out the drought-stricken farmers of Texas because that's not all the members of the Republic that you're dealing with. And so it was Grover Cleveland that vetoed the bill, as he did 534 other bills that Congress presented. Grover Cleveland, remember Grover Cleveland? He was a great president, along with Calvin Coolidge and some of those other unknown presidents we never hear about. Don't give credit to those pious humbugs that had thousands and hundreds of thousands of our best men sent to slaughter. They weren't the great presidents. They were the pious humbugs that claimed they were great. And historians today write how great they were. I read this newspaper article. I'm going to give it to Patricia next week. The newspaper article from the political science professor up in Idaho Falls. Scholars have affirmed, he says. Blah, 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 blah. What scholars affirmed. I don't care what scholars affirm. What's the truth? I got scholars that affirm the opposite of what that guy pronounced. Which one do you believe? There's a new book out. I just got it. Oh, man, I'm just excited to read. It's called Recarving Rushmore. Yes? Yes, and then the front cover of the book, somehow the artists are really good at it. They have Mount Rushmore greatly changed. Huh. I thought, wow, that looks like an actual photograph, but I'm sure it's not. It looks like they've taken dynamite and blown off some of the faces that are there. That's how it appears. And then the author, who is a fine scholar, his name is Ivan Eland. Good scholar. I like his work. Other works too. That's why I ordered this book. I'm selective at what I read. And he starts out by saying, scholars affirm, when that is said, we must determine what is their measuring standard. By what measurement did they determine such and such to be great? Or so and so, which president? You know, the pious humbugs that slaughtered people are told they're great. There was just a poll, an opinion poll. You know how valuable they are. An opinion poll last month, the month of February. Who are the five greatest presidents that ever lived? Who do you think number one is? Ronald Reagan. Who's number two?
JFK.
Who's number three? No, he doesn't get in there yet.
Lincoln.
Abraham Lincoln. Who's number four?
FDR.
Who's number five? George Washington with 9% of the vote. Huh? Scholars affirmed that Ronald Reagan and on down that list. Scholars affirmed, what was their measuring standard? I didn't affirm that. Some people think I'm a scholar. Oh, I'm not really. I'm a blacksmith. What is a scholar? What humbug that goes to college and gets a PhD degree and hangs it out and says, I'm now a scholar, and then he gives you this goofy nonsense that makes no sense whatever, and he gets elected to be your representative, and he goes back to Washington, D.C. with the same goofy nonsense. Is that a scholar? Are we having fun yet? Okay. The 10th Amendment. Now, there's a movement. We mentioned it earlier in the other lesson. The 10th Amendment movement. In the days that they were trying to decide whether to ratify the Constitution, there was a great debate between the Federalist and the Anti-Federalist. And the Anti-Federalists were good people, and they had some good points. And they didn't lead, they didn't win, the Federalists won out. But what they did do was they got the Bill of Rights in by their arguments. And the arguments went to each state as to what should we put in the Bill of Rights. And this 10th Amendment was one of the most important debated issues. So when they came back from the states with their suggestions, from the state of Maryland, they suggested they have an amendment in the Bill of Rights that declares, Congress shall exercise no power but what is expressly delegated by this Constitution. That's pretty clear, isn't it? Massachusetts wrote, all powers not expressly delegated by the aforesaid Constitution are reserved by the several states to be by them exercised. South Carolina wrote, the states retain every power not expressly relinquished by them and vested in the general government of the Union. Vested, remember, you can give the vest and you can take the vest away. The states had that power. News release. March the 30th, 2009. Now we like to bring current news. That's pretty current, isn't it? That's this week's magazine, with other words, and they labeled it with March the 30th, 2009. Taking on the feds. With Oklahoma leading the way, the juggernaut known as the 10th Amendment movement is gaining steam across the nation. Okay, the 10th Amendment movement is gaining steam. That means that the state of Oklahoma has passed a resolution saying that they demand the federal government honor the 10th Amendment. Wow! Wouldn't that be unusual? It's the most violated part of the entire document. Completely, totally ignored by the federal government for generations. And now the states are starting to demand. Well, a resolution is just a resolution, doesn't mean a thing. Except it's an idea. Ideas have consequences. And this is an idea that it claims here is going across like a steamroller, gaining steam across the nation. I hope Utah is considering it. If you don't know, contact your legislator or your senator and encourage them to get in touch with the 10th Amendment resolution. It's a very worthwhile project. Amendment 10. Here's what they finally did. The power is not delegated to the United States by the Constitution, nor prohibited by it to the states, are reserved to the states respectively or to the people. That's the 10th Amendment. And that's what the big steamroller is doing now. They hope it's a steamroller. So far, it's just a little wisp of steam. But anyway, that's the 10th. That's a great one. Too bad it's ignored. Thomas Jefferson, the State of the Union Address. There are individuals who want to apply federal tax dollars to the great purposes of the public education, roads, rivers, canals, and other such objects of the public improvement as it may be thought proper to add to the constitutional enumeration of federal powers. I suppose an amendment to the Constitution by consent of the states necessary, because the objects now recommended are not among those enumerated in the Constitution and to which it permits the public money to be applied. What was he objecting to? He was objecting to signing legislation. See, Congress had passed legislation. They wanted to spend money on roads and rivers and canals and public education. And Jefferson says, I refuse to sign it, because there is no enumeration in the Constitution allowing you to spend money on those projects. Isn't that interesting? Warning. This is from the Kentucky Resolutions. If those who administer the general government be permitted to transgress the limits fixed by the compact, by a total disregard to the special delegations of power therein contained, annihilation of the state governments and the erection upon their ruins of a general consolidated government will be the inevitable consequence. That happened. What Jefferson foresaw took place. And today we're living under a general consolidated government which was erected on the ruins of the Republic of Republics. It took a long time, a slow process. Stephen Breyer, Antonin Scalia, one a living constitutionalist, the other an originalist. Most people think the battle is conservatives versus liberals, when it is actually originalist versus living constitutionalist. Separation. This is the third word in our closing lesson tonight. Separation means separation of powers. Back to the Federalist Papers, a great place to learn what happened and what they believed in the Constitution. The accumulation of all powers, legislative, executive, and judiciary, in the same hands, whether of one, a few, or many, and whether hereditary, self-appointed, or elective, may justly be pronounced the very definition of tyranny. The accumulation of all powers, legislative, executive, and judiciary, in the same hands, may justly be pronounced the very definition of tyranny. We have that all around us in the United States government today, where an agency of the government has all three powers in their agency. A voluntary compact, we're back to this illustration of the hand, between free, independent, and sovereign states. The sovereign states established the Constitution, they ratified the Constitution voluntarily, and they maintained all of their sovereignty. They gave no sovereignty away, because you can't divide sovereignty. They created in that Constitution a legislative, an executive, and a judicial. And the judicial branch is on the little pinky because it is the least powerful of the three branches of government in 1789. Today, it's the most powerful of the three branches of government, as they tell us what the Constitution means. And it means whatever they conjure up in their minds to make it mean. And the United States of America Is or was? It used to be is or are? It used to be are. And now it's is. Okay. Now we can't end this lesson without saying something about the Declaration of Prohibitions. Huh? I've heard of the Declaration of Independence, but what's the Declaration of Prohibitions? Have you ever heard of the Bill of Rights? The famous Bill of Rights? Does it identify your rights, or is it a Declaration of Prohibitions? Let's take a look at it. Thought-provoking, worthwhile. Fact. The matter of whether or not to include a Bill of Rights in the Constitution was brought up before the Philadelphia Convention and was rejected unanimously. Huh? Why, the famous Bill of Rights? You mean the men that wrote the Constitution didn't want the Bill of Rights? That's right, they didn't. They rejected it, according to Kendall and Carey, unanimously. None of the people that drafted the Constitution wanted a Bill of Rights. Well, why not? Here's the reasons. Here are the reasons. This is the Convention of States, another well-known painting. 12 nations sent representatives. Which one didn't send representatives? Rhode Island. They met in Philadelphia in September of 1787. They gathered for the signing of their compact, which was called the Constitution. The people retain everything they do not by express terms give up. Hence, a Bill of Rights is nugatory, as George Washington arguing. We don't need a Bill of Rights unless they specifically delegated that power to the central government. They retain the rights. We don't want to try and list their rights. The Bill of Rights is not a declaration of rights, but rather is more like a declaration of prohibitions. These were the arguments that were made at the convention. This is a summary of it. The Bill of Rights is unnecessary, would be dangerous, is incompatible with the Philadelphia Constitution, as they debated whether or not to have a Bill of Rights. Here we have the two books, the Federalist Papers and the Anti-Federalist Papers. And if you study one, you ought to plan on studying the other one so that you can see the viewpoints of a broader spectrum of the people who were there working on drafting and preparing our system of government. The proposed Bill of Rights, 189 suggestions came in from the states. They were boiled down by James Madison to 17. The 17 went before Congress, and Congress approved 12. And then they were sent out to the states to see if the states would accept or ratify these 12 proposed amendments. And, oh, that's another evening's lesson all of its own that we won't do here. Amendments to the Constitution after the Bill of Rights. Anyway, the 13th Amendment, the 14th Amendment, the 16th Amendment, the 17th Amendment, all have serious problems. Serious problems. The state of Utah in 1963 said of the 14th Amendment, quote, "It was foisted upon the people of this country." Foisted? That's the Utah Supreme Court unanimously agreeing that the 14th Amendment was fraudulently passed. And then they put 5 pages into the Utah state law defining and describing how that took place. It's a very interesting case. It's called Diet versus Turner. D-Y-E-T-T is the word diet. Well, they went back to the states, or out to the states, and the states ratified 10. And this became our famous Bill of Rights, a part of the Constitution. Most people have never heard of the preamble to the Bill of Rights. Now, a preamble does have value. And so if you'll turn to page 20, you're going to see the preamble to the Bill of Rights. Usually it isn't even printed in the Constitution booklets. They just ignore it and they start with the Amendment 1 and so forth. So on page 20, the very beginning of the Bill of Rights is the preamble. Now we're going to enlarge it here. It's that portion right up at the top of the page. Here it comes. The conventions of a number of states, having at the time of their adopting the Constitution, expressed a desire, in order to prevent misconstruction or abuse of its powers, that further declaratory and restrictive clauses should be added. and as extending the ground of public confidence in the government will best ensure the beneficent ends of its institution. So why did they write the Bill of Rights? In order to prevent misconstruction or abuse of its powers, further declaratory and restrictive clauses were added. That's why they wrote the Bill of Rights. It didn't change anything. The Bill of Rights doesn't change anything in the meaning of the Constitution. Not a single thing has changed. All they did was provided further explanation in hope that later generations could understand better what they meant. I was on a radio talk show one night in Texas, and somebody called in. We were talking about the Constitution and the Bill of Rights. And I remember the person said, "The Constitution was so poorly written that they immediately started amending it." Is that true? Was it so poorly written they immediately started amending it? Nonsense. I didn't say that on the air. I said, "Well, give me an example, you know. Show me something in the Constitution that was changed by the Bill of Rights." "Well, just the fact that they're called amendments means they changed it." That's the furthest we could get. The person on the other end wasn't able to give a single example of anything it changed. All it did was... Anyway, we didn't make any headway. I'm sure they didn't get converted, but it doesn't change anything. And yet, they're beautiful explanations to prevent misconstruction or abuse. Did it work? Did the Bill of Rights prevent misconstruction and abuse? No. Now, the Bill of Rights is over. We have been run over like roughshod. That's the word, roughshod. Back in Beaver, in the old days in Beaver. I'll bet your great-grandfathers roughshod their horses in the winter. Anybody remember any of that story, that history? Roughshod horses so they can walk on the ice without falling. And they have great big cleats on the bottom of their shoes. I don't see any old-timers in here. None of you are old enough. My dad knows about it. My dad used to roughshod his horses. He's 97 years old. If he's alive tonight, I'll be grateful. He's on his last legs yesterday. They roughshod their horses. Well, a phrase then, over the years, we've used term roughshod. It means the horse is able to stomp around and kick and scratch and beat, and he'll cut his own legs, he'll raise his hooves up and slash his legs, but they can stand up on the ice. So when you run roughshod over something, it's bad. The Constitution has been run roughshod over for a long time and abused and neglected and ignored. Now, this is really a declaration of prohibitions. Here's what they were prohibiting. Congress shall make no law. Now, that's a prohibition. That's not the granting of a right. We call it the Bill of Rights, but it's a declaration of prohibitions. Then it goes on to say what they shall make no law to deal with. Freedom of religion, freedom of speech, right to assemble. They're not going to make any laws against that. The right of the people to keep and bear arms shall not be infringed. There's no doubt what that means. No soldier shall, see these are prohibitions, shall not be violated. That's the Fourth Amendment. It talks about shall not be violated. No person shall be held. You get the idea? Prohibitions. This is not identifying rights, etc. Number 84, Alexander Hamilton summarized. A Bill of Rights would be dangerous. It would afford a colorable pretext to claim more powers than were granted. A colorable pretext is like a lie. It's going to lie to you, and then people will claim more powers than were granted. We should not declare that things shall not be done which there is no power to do. In the Bill of Rights, we got freedom of the press. Well, there was no power authorized in the Constitution to do anything with the press. So why should we declare it in the Bill of Rights? It will furnish to men disposed to usurp a plausible pretense for claiming power. Disposed to usurp. Do you think there are very many people that are just disposed to usurp? That seems to be the power, what does it say? The disposition of nearly all men, when they get a little power, is try to get more. They're disposed to usurp. And then they have a plausible pretense, an excuse for usurping, because of what it says in the Bill of Rights. The 14th Amendment is a good example. The Supreme Court twisted and perverted the 14th Amendment that was passed fraudulently. This is history most people don't know anything about. Dyett versus Turner is one of the examples. There are several others where we see that the 14th Amendment was passed fraudulently, and then the Supreme Court twisted the fraudulent 14th Amendment to mean something opposite to what it says. And guess what they can do? They can have millions upon millions of unborn children slaughtered because of the use of the 14th Amendment in a twisted manner. Or they can overturn the state of Texas's laws against sodomy because they twist the 14th Amendment in a certain manner. The 14th Amendment was an abomination to the Constitution. The doctrine of constructive powers will be abused by an injudicious zeal for bills of rights. These are out of Alexander Hamilton's Federalist Paper statement, why we shouldn't have a Bill of Rights. An injudicious zeal, I've seen that in textbooks. You'll see the official literature, the local high school textbook style of literature, and it will have an injudicious zeal for the Bill of Rights. Just gushy about the Bill of Rights. Like 17 pages about why the First Amendment was a glorious amendment and we should have freedom from religion. Huh? Yeah, that's what they do. They take the First Amendment, declare we're going to have freedom from religion. That means nobody in any way can have religion in a public institution. That's what they want to have happen. We've got to remove the Ten Commandments because the children may read them and follow them. That's the quotation from a Supreme Court case. This is an injudicious zeal for a Bill of Rights. Of course, they say nothing about the Second Amendment in that same textbook. I'm referring specifically to a textbook, a specific book, paid for by tax dollars. With no oversight from Congress, they produced a series of history books for the schools of America that can be purchased at a very bargain rate. So if a school district is having trouble getting finances, they can buy these history books created by the federal government through a private agency with no oversight. Sound bizarre? Sounds bizarre to me. I just know it's true. I own the history books. And in there they show that 17 pages of a certain history book, of that history book, are about the First Amendment. No pages about the Second Amendment. It's supposed to be a history book. It's supposed to teach us the American history. And no pages about the Ninth or Tenth Amendments. There's no explanation about the federal government's abuse of number 10 and number 9. Wow. This particular statement from Hamilton was prophetic. It all took place, everything he promised. And he wrote that in the Federalist Papers, number 84, in the year 1788. This is an interesting one. Next week, we're going to learn about Hamilton versus Jefferson, Hamiltonian thinking versus Jeffersonian thinking. I bought this book in 1961. That's my copy of the Federalist Papers. It was brand new then. You always want to take care of your books. And you can notice up here that it's old by the price. What's that price? $1.95. This is the same identical book with a different cover. Huh. $7.95 it says on this book. $7.95. Next week's first lesson is on money. What has the government done to our money? If that doesn't interest you, nothing will. With all of the bailout programs and all of the finance, the scenarios, all the things going on with the Federal Reserve and the Treasury, we will explain to you in detail what the government has done to our money. That's the first lesson next week. I believe I've got my schedule right. Anyway, what I found interesting here was, here we have on this book in 1961, all three men's pictures. Hamilton and Madison contributed by far the most, Jay a little. But they're all represented. Madison, the father of the Constitution, made a major contribution in the book. Why did they drop Madison out and put only Hamilton on the front cover? It's because we're in Hamiltonian society today. We have adopted the teachings of Alexander Hamilton. That's my opinion. That's why I think they chose not to put Madison on. Just honor Hamilton on the front cover. Well, that's a 2006 book. Let's go to this quotation. There remains but one other view of this matter to conclude the point. Now they're talking about the Bill of Rights. The truth is, after all the declamations we have heard, that the Constitution is itself, in every rational sense and to every useful purpose, a Bill of Rights. The several Bills of Rights in Great Britain form its Constitution, and conversely, the Constitution of each state is its Bill of Rights. And the proposed Constitution, if adopted, will be the Bill of Rights of the Union. That was what they believed. Now, original intent sometimes confuses people, because original intent is present intent. See, original intent doesn't change. If it was the original intent 100 years ago, it's still the original intent. But we're in the present day today. And so the original intent is present intent. In the year 2001, when George Fletcher, law professor at Columbia Law School, wrote this book, Our Secret Constitution, he has a section titled, The Irrelevance of Original Intent. That's a section in this living constitutionalist history writer. He's a law professor writing history. And he has a section that the original intent doesn't make any difference. It doesn't matter. It's irrelevant. Do you believe that? That's his opinion. It's an interesting book to read. I really enjoy reading it. It's great. I learned a lot from this professor. Where are we today? Okay, we've had about 2.5 hours of rather hard, heavy material that some of you have never heard before. You might even be in a state of cognitive dissonance. Yeah. Last week we learned what that meant, right, Joe? Yeah, cognitive dissonance, kind of painful. You didn't want to hear that. One man came up at the end of one of my lectures, and he was respectful and kind, and he said, I'd rather you hadn't said some of the things that you said. Well, that's because it hurts. We don't want to hear that the government has abandoned us and is running roughshod over us. We don't want to hear that. We'd rather hear some warm, fuzzy thing about born on the 4th of July or something. Where are we today? Now, we're going to jump a whole bunch of history that we'll cover next week and the following week. And we're going to answer that question. This is, again, back to 1878. This is the illustration he shows where they were in 1878. And you'll learn something about where we are today by looking at this old diagram. In 1878, he said, Bernard Sage, now the government has absolute supremacy. In 1878, the government tells us what the Constitution means, and the states have become administrative agencies, and they're under the Constitution. Instead of the Constitution being a compact between the states, they are now subjected to the Constitution as administered and defined by the federal government. And to all that, the people are the subjects. That was 1878. Great illustration. He did a good job. How is it, Bernard Sage asked, how is it that in 1788, the states were in the top grade of authority when 1866 found them in the third? What happened? There's 550 pages in his book that explain what happened. The short answer. This is the short answer. I wrote this today. In a convention in Philadelphia in 1866. Now, you've all heard of the convention of 1787. The convention of states that wrote the Constitution. You have all heard of the convention of 1776. What do we write then? The Declaration. But who in the world has ever heard of the convention in Philadelphia in 1866? In a convention in Philadelphia in 1866, the new national government announced its absolute supremacy. We'll give you their direct quotations next week. The government was now over the Constitution and would tell the states what the Constitution means. The states would be merely administrative agencies for the new central power. Coerced by bloodshed and violence, the people were now involuntary subjects of this new system. More about what happened in Lesson Rise to Empire. Here we are today now. Obama has assumed the office of president, endowed with extraordinary powers, never intended by our founders, and he plans to use them like never before. But that won't be new. The presidents have been doing this for years, for generations. They've been abusing the powers granted to the president. A presidency fit for a king, an imperial presidency. The supremacist judges pretend they are interpreting the Constitution. For the last 80 or 90 years, we've had a majority of the court that generally pretends and follow the whims of man. Last week, we talked about that. We had the picture of your great-great-grandmother on the screen last week, and we found out how Darwinian evolution affected the Supreme Court. Sound bizarre? Watch the DVD that I gave you. They're over on the table. You can have one or pay 43 cents and cover my cost. That was last week's lesson. The supremacist judges pretend they are interpreting. That's not my phrasing. That's out of a high scholar, high quality scholar's book. Phyllis Schlafly, I recall, was the scholar, and says they are pretending that they interpret the Constitution. Oh, what's this? What are these people doing? Our opening talk this evening, the young man swore an oath to uphold and defend something. These people are swearing an oath. Where is that? That's Congress, the United States Congress. And we'll also show you a very interesting symbols that are on the walls right behind you. You can see it right there. Next week, we'll show you a picture of what's on each side of the podium. And you'll gasp. I'm not going to spill the beans and tell you what it is tonight, but you'll be alarmed and surprised at what we hang out in front of everybody. This is what America is all about. Here these people are holding their hand up. What do you suppose they're doing? They're taking an oath to uphold and defend the Constitution of the United States against all enemies, both foreign and domestic. So help me God. There's not but one person in that entire audience, just one, that maintains the consistent support of the Constitution. What's his name?
Ron
Paul. I've known him for 20 plus years, and he has consistently followed the principles of the Constitution his entire career. He's a medical doctor trying to do something to preserve liberty in the land. His slogan is Campaign for Liberty. Another one is Try Liberty. Well, what should we do? The people say, what should we do? He says, try liberty. Not a bad idea. You know, think about that now. A Congress that does not seem to have the faintest conception of the type of government once known as the American Republic. There's not a person there that seems to understand by their voting record. I'm going by their voting records. Their voting records are atrocious. What's next? Next week, Know Your Liberty. Friday, April the 3rd. Now we're going to do it Friday night, next week. Beaver Opera House, 6:30. And we're going to cover the rise to empire, but there's one other lesson. I think it's the whatever happened to our money. What has the government done to our money? That's a fun one. That's fun to give. Ah, there's the printing press. The date was July the 5th, 2007. We were under contract with the federal government, my son and I. That's my son right there. This is in Benjamin Franklin's grandson's print shop in Independence National Park. They said, please don't deliver the press on July the 4th. The park's busy then. It's right around the corner from Independence Hall. And so on July the 5th, we delivered the press. And we're setting this up. This is a very close replica. This is what we do at my shop. A very close replica of the press in the Smithsonian Institute that was used to print various famous documents. And that's the style of press that would have printed the first Constitution, which was a newspaper printed on September the 19th, 1787. It was the Pennsylvania Packet. The power of a newspaper cannot be overlooked. And it was the front page news. It was great, great news. The Constitution of the United States on the front page, all of the text spelled out. When we got done, at the end of the day, we went around the corner, just walked around the corner, and one of the park rangers was with us, and he took us on a quick tour, personal tour of Independence Hall. And now you can see the clock right up here. It's 10 minutes past 6 in the evening. All the rangers are pretty well gone home. The tours are over for the day. The tourists have dissipated, and the street was quite reasonably quiet and peaceful. And I stood back and I took this picture. And when I got home, I looked at the picture and I kept thinking, you know, I feel like I see someone standing in front of the hall. Yes, I think I recognize that person. Yes. And on the table in front of him are two documents. The Constitution of the United States and the Declaration of Independence. And the spirit of George Washington is standing out in front of Independence Hall every day. And the hundreds and the thousands of tourists are milling around and going back and forth. And the tour leader, he announces, "We should be grateful that the government established by our founding fathers is alive and well today. That our Constitution is still alive and well, and we're following it." He says that. I was there. I was in the tour. And poor old George Washington can't hardly get a glimmer of interest as he holds that pen out. "Will you subscribe? Will you sign your name? Will you pledge your life and your fortune and your sacred honor to the cause of liberty that we established for you?" If he could speak, I believe he would probably say something like this: "There is indeed a cause, and God is waiting for his people to stand in faith, to let their light shine in the darkness that threatens to engulf us. Can he count on you?" There are bundles of these over on the table. If you don't find what you want, please use them as a tool. A tool to encourage other people to participate in the cause of liberty. First by reading their contract, and then perhaps finding a way to support and uphold and defend it. Many of the good people that have sworn an oath to uphold and defend it haven't read it. Read the contract. Good starting point. Start with the Declaration of Independence, even though it's not at the first of the book. Go to the back of the book. Go to the legal basis for our society, and then read the Constitution. Somebody read it and reported back. And they said, "You know, it took me 40 minutes to read the Constitution and 20 minutes to read the amendments." Now, they didn't give me a timing on the Declaration, but it would be about the same time, short. That's all. We're asking for a commitment of 1 hour, or maybe two if you're a slow reader, to read the contract. It was meant to be read and followed. It means what it says. The words all had meaning. I gave one of these to a lawyer one day, and he said, "Oh," he says, "that's not a good project, handing constitutions out. Nobody can understand it. Law schools don't even teach it generally. They teach what they call constitutional law. And yet the law professors that I've spoken with, a goodly number of them say, we were never even asked to read the Constitution. That has nothing to do with constitutional law." And one young man that was a new graduate from the law school, he says, he was on the airline, I remember sitting on the airline with him, we were talking about this. He says, "My professor told me not to read the Constitution, but it was too confusing." My dear friends, try liberty. This is the key. In the last hours before his death, we started out this evening with our Savior as we talked about the roots of America, the Pilgrims and the Puritans. In the last hours before his death, he's visiting with his dearest friends. And he turns to Peter and he says, "Simon, Simon, Satan desireth thee to sift thee as wheat. But I have prayed for thee that thy faith fail not. When thou art converted, strengthen thy brethren." I am converted. I'm grateful that you came this evening that I might share this message with you. I have hope in America. I love my country. I do not love the government that's now running the country. I love the great principles of the founding fathers that are written in these great documents of freedom. When thou art converted, strengthen thy brethren. This grand old man, his name is Bert Smith, has been my dear friend for more than 30 years. We started in this cause together when I was young and had dark black hair. And he was just a middle-aged man then. Now he's 88 now, turning 89 very soon. He's been in this cause with me. He had the blessing of earning money. I didn't get that blessing. And so he spends his money in trying, and has for over 30 years, in trying to promote the cause of liberty. I mentioned to you earlier in the evening, he just refinanced again another 100,000 books to try and spread the message. He makes nothing. He loses. Every time he spends money, he hopes he can get enough donations. This is his donation bucket up here. He hopes we can get enough donations to cover the cost. That's all he hopes for. And he was jubilant when the Supreme Court of the state of Florida ordered 90,000 copies of the Constitution. They ordered 45,000 in the first order, 40,000 in the next order, and 5,000 in the third order. The Supreme Court of Florida is passing the Constitution out in Florida. Couldn't Utah do something like that? Start in your own home. Don't worry about the legislature passing them out. Do it yourself. The old gentleman furnished the paper for the 2.5 million copies. And he says, all you have to do, speaking to me, is ask him to cover the rest of the printing cost. 30 cents. He says, I'll take care of the rest. And that's 20 cents he's covering. So he says, sell them, ask for donations, give them out if you have to. 30 cents each, and he'll cover the balance. I have about 300 here tonight. If you want to take more than one home, make a donation of 30 cents each. If you can't handle that, I'll give you a bundle. Compliments of Smith and Edwards in Ogden. Would the audience please stand? As we showed you last week, we like to close with a song. We picked hymns that fit the Christian world. America is a Christian nation. The hymn I've chosen for this evening, I don't have a musical accompaniment, but you're mostly familiar with it. Praise God from whom all blessings flow. But most of you probably don't know that there's a second verse. Usually there's just one verse published. If I went the correct direction, there is a second verse. And so please, try with me to sing both verses. If we can come up with some kind of a melody and a starting point, let's see. Praise God from whom all blessings flow. Praise Him, all creatures here below. Praise Him above, ye heavenly host. Praise Father, Son, and Holy Ghost. Shout to Jehovah, all the earth. Serve ye Jehovah with gladness. Before Him come with singing mirth. Know that Jehovah, He God is. Just please have our benediction. Please stay standing for the prayer.
Heavenly Father, thankful for this day. Thankful so much that we're able to come and listen to Mr. Pratt speak tonight. And please, that we will be able to take his lesson to heart, and that we will be able to spread the message and bring more people back for next week. We're thankful so much that we're able to be here. And please, those driving home, that we will be safe. And please, that we will remember this lesson, and that it will do good in our lives. And we say it in the name of Jesus Christ. Amen.
Amen.